God is good. And all the time. Amen, my friends. If you're not supporting us, of course, you can see on the screen behind me or follow along in your programs as well. If you're a guest today, we'd love for you to fill out a guest card. You know, our guest cards are our prayer cards because we intentionally pray for each other. Just drop those cards off in the offering plate, which is right by where they are. Sending our programs in the back. Youth group will kick off here in the fall. We'll give you more information to our students as soon as possible. And youth group, which is our Sunday school, will be kicking off September 8th with a blessing of the backpacks of both services that Sunday morning. And then, of course, Sunday school begins at 10:10 Sunday mornings. Meanwhile, our Give Thanks meal is October 16th. Make sure you sign up as soon as possible as we give thanks to those who fearlessly serve. Whether it be the local EMTs, the fire department, police, and so on. But after having to spend some time with folks at the local fire department for this Friday's funeral service, they are still incredibly appreciative. 10 months later, I said thank you. So well done, friends. That's coming up October 16th. And on September 9th, we'll be meeting for our 200th anniversary preparation time. If you're interested at all in the 200th anniversary of Mercy United Methodist Church, which we will celebrate on October 11, 2020. Thankfully, we are not going back in time. There's no log cabin, no horses that will be bringing us to worship that day. And thankfully, no Presbyterians throwing rocks at us, because when Methodists first moved to the Mercy, they threw rocks at the Methodists. Yeah. So hopefully things have changed, but we'll find out in October 11, 2020. But set down your calendars. We'll meet again Monday night at 6:30 p.m. here at the church. If you're at all interested and can't make it, then let us know. If you want to honor the church and our history and to truly celebrate the rejoice of this time aside. In fact, friends, thank you. One, we had a surprise funeral dinner meal for Judy Armstrong, who would be Evelyn May's sister. Evelyn goes to the 11 o'clock service. Her daughter, is Sherry Finley. Sherry's husband is Brian Finley, which would be Katie Finley's grandson. Y'all get all that? You do the math? Listen, I know I've been here 5 years, but that makes total sense to me what I just said. Yes, that is what I say makes sense, at least to me. We'll move on. So with that being said, thank you so much to all of you who were here to help, especially to Joanne, who made sure that everything occurred and wrangled all the volunteers, to Jim, as well as to Joe and Cheryl and Peggy and Kathy for coming to help on Friday. Then also, for the church picnic yesterday, thank you so much to the fellowship team, whether it be Alicia or the Amons, both Jerry as well as Carol, well, and everybody else for the work they put in to make sure yesterday worked so well. And Linda, thank you for bringing the chicken. What a gift. So friends, thank you so much for everything you do. Let's greet one another with the love of Christ.
Thank you. Thank you.
on the church picnic? I mean, it's pretty obvious you're all right up here. What was your favorite part of the church picnic? Swimming? What about you, Emily? Me going down the slide. They're not supposed to know about that. What about you, Maddie? What's your favorite part?
Swimming.
Swimming? Okay. Was your favorite part whenever I threw you in the air? No, wait, that might be one of my favorite parts. I know, give you that look. No, yeah, that was definitely a lot of fun yesterday. And so with the church picnic and how I get to know you guys, there are a lot of gifts each of you has. What do you think you do well? Like, what do you think are some of the best things you're able to do? Nothing? Really? Read? Great. Thanks, Rachel. What else do you think you do well? Rachel said reading. Good stuff. And?
Showing?
Showing cow. Okay, is that for 4-H? Or? Okay, awesome. Now, what do you show them? Your books. I know. Ha ha ha. Really bad joke. Now, what do you do for showing, Rachel? What's so special about this? I never did 4-H when I was growing up.
We did spend time with our animals.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now what do you practice with them when they listen to you? No, really, what do you practice? Like walking them or?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't thinking of you growing them. What's that, Rachel?
Setting them up.
Okay. Awesome. That takes a lot of work, doesn't it? What about you, Emily? What do you think you do well?
Like
to ride horses?
Right.
Right. So I hope you don't like to ride horses, because yeah, I don't know if they can breathe. But if Rachel can work with them, maybe they can. Yeah. What do you like to write? Stories? How cool. Okay. Now, has anybody ever read them, or are they for yourself right now? Okay. Wow. You know you hit it, the jackpot whenever your teacher reads what you wrote. What's that? Okay, well, it's an assignment. Okay. So you're not saying you're sometimes some folks will write stories and they hide them away and they ever read some, but yeah, you do it for school so far. Okay. Thanks, Emily. Well, I've heard that all three of you sing. Yeah. Incredible. What about you, Andy? What do you think you do well? You go ahead and give me that look. Adeline, do you wrestle?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Are you pretty good at wrestling? Since you beat on the boys? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And with dance. And if you and Jen are together, you can do numbers for me from the Disney movies. Really, Descendants 3. I've seen the two of you sing and dance to that. If nothing else, we'll ask your aunts if you can. If I tried to do it, somebody would call a doctor because they thought I was having some sort of medical emergency. You guys make that look good. See, there are so many things that you do well. What I see out of all of you is how you're caring and loving, although one of you at least likes to step on my shoes once in a while. Besides that, how kind you are to be here at the church picnic, how kind you are to other folks. I watched you with adults do so many kind things. Really, the three of you impress me. Quite a bit. So that being said, though, if I help others, there's something better or greater than how well we can write, how well we can show our animals, how well we can dance, how well we can sing. There's something even better or greater than any of those other things that we can do. You ready for it? I think the greatest thing to do. Ready? Are you sure? The greatest thing. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13. And now these three remain. Faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. So no matter how great we are at writing, no matter how great we are at showing animals, no matter how great we are at school, no matter how great we are at gymnastics or wrestling or whatever it may be, no matter how great we are at whatever we do, the greatest thing we can be about, though, is love. Which means showing other people love. Not just like, I feel it, but actually showing people we love them. Now, between us, how you do that for everybody? Whole different ball of wax. But show somebody your love. That's the greatest thing you can do. So let's pray. Father, help us to show the people we love. Thank you so much that you find that to be the greatest thing we can do. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we're talking about loving the greatest, but got me thinking about the greatest candies ever made. So I've got two of them. I couldn't find Swedish fish in the little packages because they're in the top three easily. But we do have here two of the greatest candies, in my opinion, which is the only one that matters when I'm going to bring some candy. that really should have bought, didn't it? I didn't ask you to do one, but I just bought one. So we have girl peppermint patties right there, and guess what's in this one? She does know me a little well. Snickers right there. Whatever you like, go ahead and grab a couple. Ladies, thank you. Great. So in other words, you're suggesting all 50 of us show up there after church. Forget fellowship time downstairs.
He has a great sense of humor, so you'll enjoy it.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. And that's Jeannie for the address, and we'll just all show up there. They've got a huge driveway, right? So we can just park it.
Yeah.
Already? Oh, we'll park at the Parkers then.
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't tell Jim. I said, oh wait. Hi, Jim. Thanks for being there for a moment. Dale.
Terry got through the surgery, so they took out three more little lumps of cancer in his head, so now we got that taken care of, hopefully. And then they'll start working on all the mistakes that were made in the past.
So praise God for successful surgery. Prayer for continued healing. Thanks, Dale, for Terry. Mark.
Prayers please for my daughter Lindsay. She's 35 weeks pregnant and we're looking at preeclampsic conditions. So we're not sure when the baby's going to come, but after Monday it'll be a plan. So please keep her in prayer.
So they're thinking he'll arrive early then, Marla.
Yes, Isabella.
Isabella. I'm sorry.
Isabella.
So she will be arriving early. Yeah. Okay. But we pray for Lindsay in the midst of. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Marla. Friends, is there anything else we ought to be praying for? David?
Yes, Lindsay's prayers, and she's having surgery tomorrow.
And so we're praying for Linda, who will be having eye surgery tomorrow. Thanks, David. Linda, we're praying for you. Look out. Friends, is there anything else we're going to thank God for? Praise God for who God is. Anything we need to be praying? Then, from offerings. Let's go to the Lord in prayer.
Been raised with Christ, set your hearts on all things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on these things above, not on earthly things. For you die, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. But you now must rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian or Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as your Lord forgave you, and over all of these virtues, put on love, which binds them together in perfect union.
Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Oh, wait, Lisa, you didn't get the other verses? Yeah, I'm so funny. Lisa's last week reading on a Sunday morning. All my fault. Well, friends, all kidding aside, to get to it, quite simply is this: love is the greatest. You'll hear this in 1 Corinthians 13 if it's read in any more weddings you have this fall or the rest of the summer here, but love is the greatest. We can talk about so many things we ought to do as Christians, so many things that we think we're supposed to be about or against, and yet love is the greatest. We can talk about all the great attributes we have and all the shortcomings we have. Love is the greatest. We can talk about all the spiritual gifts we have, or fruit of the Spirit we have, or all the sins we continue to practice, continue to fight against. And yet, what is the greatest? Love is the greatest. That's it. If you want to be about one thing as a Christian, love. Because love is the greatest. Love is the greatest. I did a Google search, and if you're not internet savvy, that just means do a search engine to look for a word, so like you might do in an index in the book and look for a certain word. So I typed in "love is the greatest" and then hit song, and this is the song that popped up. So Richard, if we're ready. Short. Wonderful. My editing, either way, leaves a lot to be desired. The Greatest Love of All, sung by Whitney Houston, decades old, is still a classic, and it's painful to listen to. Because Whitney Houston died from a drug overdose. A song that speaks about the greatest love you can find is to find your love for yourself, which is incredibly important. Let's not dismiss that. But in her own life, the drugs overtook her. There were even comments about her and Bobby Brown, her husband's reality show, about how Whitney just seemed to be in trouble, and later on with the overdose and death, indicated that something was truly amiss. And yet, when we hear the greatest commandment from Jesus, the song still carries weight. The greatest commandment is love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Incredibly powerful, incredibly important for us as Christians to love ourselves. She sings about it, but within the song, there's nothing about Jesus. That's ultimately where I find the greatest ability to love myself. Jesus Christ, the incredible love that God the Father has for 7 billion people on earth, and still knows me my name, still knows the hairs of my head. Talk about love that God has for me and for you. To be known by name. That being said, when Whitney sang these songs, or sang that song, unfortunately, it is so hard without Christ being in the center of life to truly find that kind of love for yourself. When we read in 1 Corinthians, we see how love is the greatest. You read through all of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 13, and 14, it actually gets at the spiritual gifts, these giftings that God gives through the Holy Spirit for us for different aspects of life within the church. And there are so many different gifts that are listed, but often we in the church focus on one, and that's tongues, that ability to speak in another language. And Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 12 and 14, that's really not that important. It's one of the weakest points, one of the weakest gifts. What is the greatest gift? He goes to 1 Corinthians 13 and tells us how great love is. Compared to everything else, it's a clashing cymbal or banging gong. And yet, with love, it makes sense and makes beautiful music. That there's something incredible about love in our lives. The greatest of these, with faith, hope, and love, the greatest of all of these is love. We can focus on all the stuff we do as Christians, whether it's preaching or teaching or serving or sweeping or whatever it might be. And the greatest, though, is love. That's what we read from Colossians chapter 3. It puts this together for us in a powerful way, although at least I know it went on forever and ever. You're welcome. From Colossians chapter 3, it lists all of these things that Christians can do that are both good and the things that we as Christians should not be about. And yet what's greater than all of them? Love. Paul writes to the church of Colossae the things that we should be putting to death. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, anger, rage, malice, slander, filthy language, lying. And then Paul goes on to even describe the things that we as Christians should be about, the things that should come out of our lives. Compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, bearing with each other, and forgiving one another, if any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And then it gets to it. What's the greatest, though? And binding, let me read it properly, over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Ties them all together. What is greatest? It's not the stuff we do. It's love. It's not how well you can speak in public. It's love. It's not how well you can make sure that the sound system doesn't taint. Great job, Kale. It is love. It's not about how great your baked beans or the pies were yesterday, or the peach cobbler. I'm starting to celebrate here. Or the chocolate chip cookies my wife made, which I had, of course, had as we would say in the movie Casablanca. I had to have carrying charges to make sure they made it to the picnic. Or the fresh fruits, or the chicken. Boy, I'm getting really hungry. Pardon me. What's the greatest? Love. We can be about a whole bunch of different things, friends, but what is the greatest? The greatest of these is love. And yet, as Christians, we often start getting into our heads that we've got to have this resume listing of all the good things we do. Or for many of us, I can't do that, or that. So so I can't do anything. And the Apostle Paul would say, what is the greatest of these? Love. But what is love? John chapter 15 puts it this way. My command is this, said Jesus. Love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay their life down for someone else. The ultimate way to show love is to sacrifice yourself for someone else. I don't mean terminally. I don't mean permanently. But how often do we put ourselves first? I want. My marriage with my wife is so much better when I'm intentional about trying to do what makes life best for her. So for example, for our anniversary, if you don't want to follow Facebook, this is what I got my wife for our anniversary. Pink flamingo items. Yes, I'm a man of romance. And I remain a frugality because we went to the Family Dollar and I found flamingo plates and flamingo napkins and a door greeting sign which says Aloha. None of this is even close to being Hawaiian. Hawaiian, yeah, there we go. Put that on the door. I made sure I inflated the plastic flamingo I purchased a few months ago to remind her that I loved it, which she just loved so much when she said you really shouldn't have. As well as the matching pink inflatable life-saving tube, as well as a little miniature inflatable surfboard so that the flamingo can go to the beach and feel safe. Yeah, somehow when we go on vacation this week, she's not at all mentioning the fact she wants to take this pink flamingo. Friends, I spent maybe $6. A man of romance here. But really, it's more of the thought that counts. Now, besides that, I also bought a rose before anybody starts thinking I'm some sort of cheapskate jerk. No, not at all. But the fun thing is buying her the flamingos. And because the previous pink flamingo I purchased for her did not survive the weed whacker while I was outside trimming the lawn, henceforth, now we also have a brand new metallic one, which the weed whacker's going to lose any battle with that sucker. And I spent a whole dollar on that. I know. You can smell the romance from there. It's all about love. It is not about the stuff or how much you spend, really. It's more about how much you care. You can spend $50 to $100 to $2,000 on someone else that own hundreds of thousands. Who cares when you're trying to buy it? It's much more about giving than getting. So yes, I drive my wife nuts with the silly, hot, pink flamingo. By the way, Peggy, that coffee mug would be great if it right in that motif, just saying. Check that out. That's around the color of the pink flamingos until they sit in the lawn out in the sun for 6 months. That being said, yeah, it's more about giving. Lay down your life for someone else. There's incredible power, friends, when you're willing to tell someone you love them. Not even just act on it, but tell them. My niece Madison, last summer, she and Connor were here for 2 months, which felt like 6 years, but that's another story for another day. And yet, there's some other things going on family-wise, and Tina and Yvonne's mom, Carol's dying. And so they were at our house, and there were days where I really pretty much would have loved to ship those kids off to Siberia. And then one day, Madison walks into the room. I think I was by myself in the room. She looked at me and she said, Uncle Brian, I love you. Well, I didn't do anything to deserve it. I think I ignored her some that morning. Uncle Brian, I love you. Changed everything. Three words, and I was putty in her hands. I wasn't expecting that. It was out of the blue. I love you. I was at the preschool this year. Went downstairs for preschool reading. And in our preschool, not the pre-K, which are like the four-year-olds getting ready for kindergarten, but in the preschool, this is organized chaos where we hope they're learning. Don't tell Sandra I said that out loud, though. But sometimes when you're downstairs, that's what it is with three-year-olds. They're just figuring out, you know, how do you put one foot in front of the other? How do you use the bathroom? Remember to wash your hands. I mean, we're working on basic things down there. So I was downstairs for preschool reading one day. My expectations weren't too high. I hope they listen once in a while. Don't beat me up too much. And then one of these little kids named Luke Finley, he's in the preschool, Katie Finley's great-grandson, looked at me, and he said, Pastor Brian, I love you. Out of the blue. And I'm like, Safe Sanctuary training suggests this, don't get alone with any student at all. Anytime you're alone with a kid, especially my role, it doesn't look good, doesn't look proper, or somebody can accuse you of something. Here I am in the free school with a little boy who's 3 years old saying, "Uncle Brian, Pastor Brian, I love you." Me being suave and debonair. Thanks, Luther. I love you too. Looked over, made sure that the teacher saw this conversation so I didn't sound even weirder than normal. But the words floored me. Friends, when it's a surprise, when somebody's offering it, love is a gift. Not to get, but to give. Love changes everything because love is the greatest. You've had it happen with kids, your grandkids, your spouse, right out of the blue. They said, "I love you." Or maybe you have shattered, destroyed, and built up someone else's day by looking at them and saying, "I love you." Love is the greatest. And that's just with the words. But something even more powerful when we're willing to live out life, live out love. It gets at that in the movie clip we have here from Wonder Woman. So, Richard, if you're ready, hit it. We are seeing here the results of Wonder Woman, who's right there, for just recently losing her love. Uh-oh.
He used to want to save the world, to end war and bring peace to mankind. But then I glimpsed the darkness that lives within their light, and learned that inside every one of them, there will always be both. A choice each must make for themselves, something no hero will ever defeat. And now I know. Only love can truly save the world.
Fascinating how truth can actually,
thanks, Dale.
How truth can actually show up in a movie. Friends, that's really the answer. Love can save the world. But you and I, we've got a small place in this world. But make it better. My world is still shaped by a little girl looking at me and saying, "Uncle Brian, I love you." My world is still shaped by a little guy who's 3 years old saying, "Pastor Brian, I love you." Imagine what you can do when you put the greatest of all of these things into action. Friends, you may be able to speak well in public. You may be able to write incredibly well. You may be able to sing like an angel. Sorry, I almost slid into a weird movie. We'll move on. But instead of all of those things, the greatest of these is love. You may be able to bake a peach pie so well that Dick Carlson might want to move in. That's an inside joke. Dick loves peach pies. We'll move on. Linda, there are probably days where you're saying, "Go ahead, Dick." But that's another story entirely. My wife says it almost every day. We'll move on. And yet, out of all of these things, love is the greatest. Friends, you may be able to do so many things so well. But the one to focus on is love. You may have so many sins in your life that it feels like they weigh you down as though you're slowly sinking. And yet the love of God is poured out on each and every one of us through His Son, Jesus Christ. The greatest of these is love. You may have such incredible attributes that people say, I wish I was like them. And yet the greatest of these is love. The 3-year-old and the 7-year-old. Not the president, not some preacher, not some important person, not an athlete. They continue to change my world. Think about it. Because friends, the greatest of these is love. And so if you, your assignment for this week, if you choose to accept it, is this. Intentionally show someone God's love. Fight through the good things and the sins that get in the way. The pride that points to yourself. And demonstrate love to someone else. There's no, I'm not going to make it easy for you. Find a way to show someone love. If you want to steal my ideas, go buy pink flamingos, but it won't make sense to them. The real way is to come from you. From how you love. And so, my friends, let us pray together. You can find the prayer on the screen behind me. If I encourage you to close your eyes, turn your hands to heaven. And let's talk with God as we pray. Friends, let us pray. Lord God, loving Father.
Lord God, loving Father.
I love you.
I love you.
Thank you that you're a loving God.
Thank you that you're a loving God.
Thank you that your perfect love never fails.
Thank you that your perfect love never fails.
Thank you for your great love.
Thank you for your great love.
Empower me to love others deeply.
Empower me to love others deeply.
I pray in the name of Jesus.
I pray in the name of Jesus.
Amen. And so, my friends, let's sing together. Let's stand as we sing.
Thank you.
passionately love another close. And often, it's us. We want, we need, or we're not feeling like it. If you want to radically demonstrate God's love to other folks, you want to love fearlessly, there's only one place to turn. Colossians 3 puts it this way. Set your minds on things above. Set your hearts on things above. In other words, turn your eyes upon Jesus. There are no shortcuts. Because the model, the demonstrator, the one who did it best, he is the one to follow. That's pity. God has already shown us how. I get in the way, you get in the way, even our little kids get in the way. Thanks be to God, though, that God can work through us. Sometimes it's that simple. Do you enjoy the air conditioning this morning?
Yes.
Did you notice it's working a little better?
Yes.
Or a lot better? Did you know what was wrong? I do. Somehow, in the last 6 years, we were lost in Breeze's system, or we lost track for trustees and pastors and staff and whatnot. As far as we can tell, according to Breeze, not once in 6 years have those filters been cleaned. Woo! And thankfully, this summer has not been warm at all. So those guys, those air conditioners, have been working double, triple duty. We left them on for vacation Bible school Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday just to make sure this place would be cool. I'm not surprised at all that they were filthy filters. Sometimes it's that simple. Simple thing to do. Instead of trying to love others on your own merit, your own abilities, turn your eyes upon Jesus. May the Lord bless you, keep you. May the Lord make his face shine bright and gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you. And as you strive to love others, may God's love be poured upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen.
They might be doing other words. It's only your first and your birthday when you're talking to God. Alright. Good job. Yeah. Hey, it's all good.